What was your first Tarantino experience? Where were you? Who were you with? What had you heard before? What were you expecting? And how emotionally jarred and shook were you when you came out of that experience? I gotta tell you guys, I was 13 years old in an unfinished basement, feeding in a VHS cassette tape of Reservoir Dogs into a VCR before sitting on my friend Mike's kind of big, giant, squishy couch. I think we had big, giant glasses of Pepsi on ice, maybe some pizza. And we watched Reservoir Dogs, my friends and I, 13-year-old boys. I mean, just I don't know how we were able to rent the rated R movie, but we did. We pulled it off, and we were shook. We were totally shook. We were like, the opening scene, Steve Buscemi, Mr. Pink, you know, going on that rant about tipping, no tipping. The plot, just how crazy and twisted it was and how jarring it was, like what was happening. The end scene, oh my gosh, the end. The torture scene, clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right. Here I am stuck in the middle with you. I don't sing for a reason, but did that bring back a memory for anybody else out there? Or did you fall in love with him? Get to know him, maybe? 1993, 1994, when Pulp Fiction came out, not only did he win the Palme d'Or, which he calls one of his most formative moments of his life, right? The top prize at Cannes Film Festival. The movie gets nominated for, of course, Best Picture, Best Director, Best Actor, Best Screenplay, everything. He takes home the Best Screenplay Award, everything. And that movie comes out. Okay, now we're like, this guy's on the map. He is one of the world's foremost directors. But then he tops it off with 1997, Jackie Brown. I was in the front row opening night with my buddies. Can't wait for this movie. We're lining up. You know, the smell of the popcorn. Everyone's itching to get into the theaters. If you've sat in a packed theater on opening night on a Tarantino film, there is a vibe, an electric vibe in that theater that is unlike seeing almost anything else. Am I right? It was 2003, I think. I was in Vancouver when Kill Bill opened up, and my friend Mike was living out there, so I go up there. I don't go up there to see the movie, but I go up there to see him, and we go see the movie. And did Kill Bill rattle you the way it rattled me? Oh my gosh, the characters, the fight scenes, the music. You know, you can just, can you feel that? Is that in your blood? Like it's in my blood? By the way, Mike, if you are listening, I still do not forgive you for right after that movie hiding from me in the giant, scary, four-level underground parking garage for like half an hour. I was like freaked out after that movie because I just watched everyone kicking the crap out of each other, and now I'm alone in a foreign city in a foreign underground parking garage looking for my friend Mike. He thought it was a funny prank. I wouldn't recommend doing that. I still feel scared about that. Was it Kill Bill 2? Was it Inglourious Basterds? Was it Django Unchained? Was it The Hateful Eight? Was it Once Upon a Time? Which movie of his was your first? What was your first Tarantino experience? If you have one, you want to share it, give me a call, 1-833-READ-ALOUD. I always love hearing from you. Because I got to tell you. And whether you're new here, by the way, if you're new, welcome. Welcome to Three Books. Welcome to our crazy international kind of crazy quest to uncover the 1,000 most formative books in the world. Welcome. Welcome to conversations with David Sedaris and Malcolm Gladwell and George Saunders and Judy Blume and Brené Brown. Welcome to conversations with world's top-ranked Uber drivers and sex workers and teenage Mormon missionaries. We don't judge on this show. No book shame. No book guilt. No shame, no guilt, period. Okay? Anti-censorship force here. Welcome. No ads, no sponsors, no commercials, no interruptions. This vibe on this show is about living full, rich, intentional lives and inspiring those lives with the power of reading. So if you're new here, welcome. We're great. We're so appreciate having you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for coming and checking us out. And if you're not new here, hey, Three Bookers, hey, Cover to Cover Club members, hi, Paper Cutters, welcome back. Welcome back. He's here. We got him. Quentin Tarantino showed up. You know, I got the email 2 weeks ago, guys. I'm going to tell you, I was freaking out. I get this email. It's like, hey, do you want to have Quentin Tarantino on your podcast? I'm like, what? this is kind of the noise comes out of my ears. I'm not kidding. Oh, I turn to Leslie. I'm like, Quentin Tarantino's in my inbox. And she's like, Neil, we're on vacation then. Like, remember we rented this lake house. We're going to try this idea. We're going to take the boys up north. I got four little boys for those that don't know me. My wife's name is Leslie for those that don't know me. We live in Toronto for those that don't know me. So I was like, the lake? Yeah, we're going to rent this lake house, but like, do they got like an internet wire up there? She's like, I don't know. I'm like, we paused for like 3 seconds. We're like, we got to do this. And so for the last 2 weeks of my life, I don't know if you would have loved to be around me or you would have not, but I rewatched all the Tarantino movies. Watched them all again. They rushed shipped me a copy of his new movie novelization, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Okay? 400 pages. Drugstore paperback edition, mass market. And it's unbelievable. It is unbelievable. It will grip you and jar you and shake you the way Death Proof did, if you saw Death Proof. It is wild. It is so rich, so trivia-laden, so propulsive. I felt like I was getting like a sub-zero kind of stab to the chest and just being pulled forward the whole book. I start reading it again. And then, of course, Quentin Tarantino sends through his three most formative books, and I go looking for them, and guess what? They're all out of print, so I'm phone up bookstores all over the place. Anyone got this? Anyone got that? Finally track it down, get stuff and, like, shipped up to this lake house, and, of course, there's no mailbox here, so then I'm, like, trying to, like, sweet-talk someone at, like, the postal service if they can open this mailbox in the little tiny village we're in, and... You know, shout out to Peter at Canada Post. Thank you. I did not own this house, but he let me into the mailbox. And you know what he said? Peter, Canada Post. He's like, I love Quentin Tarantino. Sat beside him at a restaurant in New Orleans one day. Sweetest guy. Chat with me and my wife. Then there's lots of you who say stuff like that. My friend Tracy texted me, Quentin Tarantino's going to be on 3 books. Can't wait. She's like, I sat beside him on the train. He talked to me and my friend the whole train ride. I hear this from so many people. This guy ain't painting the Sistine Chapel ceiling, but he's an artist. He's one of the best artists we have in the world. If you know, you know. Right? Am I right? So what are we going to do with our time together? And I was like going deep, right? Not only did I watch all these movies and read the books and read his formative books, which I could get my hands on and get them shipped to me, right? We're going to talk about those. But I also listened to every conversation he's ever had. He's been on 10 or 15 other podcasts. Mark Maron, Joe Rogan, shout out to those two guys. Their shows with him dropped kind of right around the pub of the books. I listened to them. Two wonderful conversations. Highly recommend them. Check out Quentin Tarantino on Mark Maron and check him out on Joe Rogan. Wonderful conversations. But I didn't want to repeat that stuff. You know, you can check those out. There's a wonderful chats. So we're going to talk, of course, about Quentin's three most favorite books. We're also going to talk about Quentin Tarantino's favorite writer. We're going to talk about how we thicken our skin. This guy's been called every name in the book. Maybe you agree with the names he's been called. Maybe you are against Tarantino. You don't like his violence. You don't like language that he uses or language that his characters use. You know, maybe you agree with all that stuff. Well, like, how does he respond to that? What's inside his mind? What's inside his body when it comes to, like, taking all these hits in public? How do you stay the course? How do you be confident through that? And what are the repercussions of that? What happens when you're confident with your artistic relationships, with your personal relationships? How do we actually live confidently in a clickbait world? What are the principles of writing movie novelizations? Movie novelizations, I mark my words, I think they're going to take off now because he's. I got a movie novelization in my house right now. It's The Lion King. Well, the book sucks. The movie novelizations kind of suck. For the most, they took the movie and now they write about Simba. I mean, this isn't going to work. It's just the pictures. But he takes the genre, this looked down upon, frowned upon genre, and he totally reinvents it. And I feel like he is starting the contemporary movie novelization comeback. So we're going to talk about how you might go about doing that. What is Hans Landa up to in Nantucket, people? Those who know the ending and the beginning of Inglourious Basterds know what I'm talking about. How do we avoid self-censorship? Okay, what are his thoughts on the meme or Quentin Quarantino? As I mentioned, his three most formative books and much, much more. I'm going to be in your left ear, people. I'm going to be in a furnace room in a lake house plugged into the only internet wire I could find in this place. 4K, surrounded by pink insulation and, like, you know, fuse tubes and all this stuff. He's going to be in his writing studio in Hollywood Hills. He's going to be in your right ear. You, my wise, kind, loving Three Books listener, will be sitting on the couch between us. Let's the three of us hang out. Okay, so whether you're doing the dishes in slow-mo, that's what I kind of do with my podcast listening, whether you're just strapping in for a long drive, whether you're trying to go to sleep or you're out for a run or you're jumping on some exercise bike, thank you for being here. Thank you for listening to Three Books. And now let's flip the page into chapter 82. Let's go, everybody. Let's go. Hello, hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, Neil.
Hi, Quentin. Oh, we're connected.
Yes.
Oh, thank you so much for calling into Three Books. I'm so grateful to you for doing this.
Oh, it's my pleasure. No, this is one of the shows I was looking forward to doing.
Oh, I'm so grateful to you for saying that. You know, I checked Amazon.com like 1 minute before you called, and as you have been, you know, for the last 5 days, you know, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is like just wedged in at the number one overall book in the world. And I'm like, I don't think I've ever had anyone on the show who, while talking to them, they got the number one, like you got the top book in the world right now, man. Congratulations.
That's really amazing. I was talking to my agent, and I was like saying, I go, okay, was the publisher, were they expecting that? Were we hoping that we would crack the top 15? I mean, you know, and they go, no one was expecting it to do that well.
I mean, but imagine it's different than like a movie opening night, right? Where you can actually go to the theater, or in this case, you're like hitting refresh on a website, you know, it feels different. I mean,
Well, it's like it is different because it's like, well, one of the big differences is, you know, you write a screenplay and then, like, that's great. And then, like, then you have to go and you have to cast the movie and do all this stuff. Then you make the movie. Then you spend all this time doing, you know, working on the post-production. So it's like this whole long thing. But, like, with a book, you finish the manuscript and then, like, then you're done, except for a little proofreading. But then it still takes, like, the publisher about, like, you know, 7 or 8 months to get it out there.
Oh, yours was fast.
Yeah. And so it's like, it's this thing that I did 9 months ago.
Exactly. Well, this, I don't, the funniest thing about this also, just as we jump, before we jump into your three books, and I tell you a little bit about the quotes I picked out from this gem I'm holding here. I'm on my second read of it.
Thank you.
I'm standing right now in a furnace room, Quentin. So my wife and I rented a lake house a couple hours north of Toronto. I found one wire in this entire joint that like plugs into the internet. I got two big vents behind me, a hot water heater, like plywood on the walls here. I got like metal, like, you know,
insulation all around you.
Exactly. And I just tweeted like a picture of it, you know. And so because I listened to your full conversations with Mark Maron and with Joe Rogan, and I saw like the velour blinds that, you know, the velour curtain in the background, I was like, oh, those guys were live. I thought we could start off by just, where are you? Are you in Hollywood Hills? What kind of room are you in? What are you seeing right now? Just so our listeners can kind of picture us both.
Oh yeah, that says no. I'm sitting in my writer's office. I'm not sitting at my desk. I'm sitting at a comfy chair that's tucked against the wall with a globe on one side and a big giant poster of Robert Mitchum from Thunder Road, right next to me against the wall, and I pointed towards my window. All right, which and my office is in my house in the Hollywood Hills. Yeah.
And I picture Filmmaker offices like you know, awards on the walls, like maybe like scotch on the side and like a crystal jar. Am I like off on that?
Yeah, no, it's like a lot of really cool posters and stuff. And there's tons of stuff piled up. All right, so I have books that I've been using as research are now all kind of neatly stacked and piled up because I've had a housekeeper come and just make take the mess and put it into neat piles as opposed to being mess all over the floor.
Yeah, I was just about to say, like, sometimes we feel really privileged to have someone come to help us clean up. We got four little boys that we need it just for, like, the pee on the wall.
Okay, you'll know where everything is when we just make it neater and, like, you're not ashamed. Your wife can look at it.
Exactly. Well, listen, I'm holding Once Upon a Time in Hollywood in my hand. Like I said, I'm on my second read. I noticed you took out the ellipsis, and I thought we could start, Quentin, by – I'm going to offer you up my in the spirit of page 36 of your book, Cliff's Top 5 Kurosawa Films, I've got my top five Hollywood quotes. Can I read them to you?
Oh, and, yes, by all means.
Okay, cool. And for you to just, you know, you can quietly nod your head or you can expand, you know, okay. Explain or elucidate as you see fit.
Okay, sounds okay. Great.
Okay, first quote, I'm going to flip to page 52. Page 52, number one, my number one quote. Life is a bleeding, screaming, violently jerking pig in your arms, and death is you holding a bunch of heavy, unmoving meat.
Truer words has never been spoken.
Okay, you're in favor of that. Yeah, that just felt to me like a metaphor for everything, for you, for the book, for just, I felt like it was a big quote.
Yeah, it's actually funny because it's, I think I had another quote very similar to that in the movie Kill Bill, where the little girl, like, takes her goldfish on the floor and stomps on it, and Bill describes it. He goes, yes, isn't that a great metaphor for life, a flapping fish on the carpet, and then a fish on the carpet not flapping?
Oh.
But it's definitely a more violent image with a pig.
It's funny you mentioned Kill Bill. That was my mental warm-up movie. So, like, an hour ago, I was watching first 20 minutes of Kill Bill as my, like, warm-up.
Oh, wow, there you go.
Yeah, just an hour ago. Okay, quote number two. I'm back on page 31 now.
Okay.
Since Cliff was so damn handsome, he appreciated other men who weren't but didn't need to be.
That sounds very much like both Cliff and Brad in real life.
Really? Because I didn't understand that at first. I was like, okay, I'm not handsome, me, Neil, personally. But I was like, I like to be appreciated by handsome men. Is that kind of the vibe? Like, the confidence
is
so...
I think it's more the vibe that Cliff is so handsome that, you know, he uses it. He can disarm people.
Yeah, exactly. Okay.
Yeah, he looks good in his clothes. He looks good. He's looked that way forever. So it's actually, you know, so he sees people who aren't like that as, you know, they're suffering under a bit of a handicap, but when they don't need to be, well, that he actually admires.
Aha. Okay, cool. I'm flipped all the way over now to page 325. You're talking about how Charles Manson helps control the environment of the people he's living with, the young people he's living with.
Uh-huh.
You say, in a head-to-head competition with the parents that they distrusted and resented, Charlie would win. In direct competition with the establishment they despised, Charlie would win. In direct competition with the philosophy contrary to Charlie's, Charlie would win. But in direct competition with the remembered pleasures of Tootsie Rolls, Fruit Loops, Clark Bars, Heyer's Root Beer, Kentucky Fried Chicken, Revlon Lipstick, CoverGirl Makeup, and Flintstones Chewable Vitamins, at some point, Charlie would lose.
You know, I have to say, hearing that taken out of context and just read aloud, I rather like that too. I was actually listening to that kind of feeling proud of myself.
You should feel proud of yourself. I underlined it twice. I underlined a sentence earlier in the same paragraph. It says, it's the commercials, the real opium of the masses that Charlie worries about. And I know how deeply researched you have been on the Charles Manson storyline. I'm assuming that comes right from something you researched.
Oh yeah, yeah. They didn't have TV privileges. They weren't allowed to watch TV. But Squeaky could watch all the TV she wanted because she was ensconced with the house with George. So whenever Charlie was away, you know, she'd let some of the kids come in and they could watch TV.
Yeah, well, it's interesting because I'm a real anti. I must be like a. I'm born in 1979, but I think of myself as like an honorary Gen Xer because I'm like I'm an anti. Ads, like I got no ads, no sponsors, no commercials, nothing on this podcast. And it's just because I hate ads. I just don't like them. But I feel out of place a lot because these days it's kind of like you're a good hustler when you know, like ads are, we bathe ourselves in ads kind of with a smile on our face these days. So
Well, yeah, I mean, like, one hand, it seemed like, you know, everyone complained about TV commercials and stuff, but then, you know, in a world now where people don't listen to CDs and they don't listen to records, but they'll just, like, listen to music on YouTube.
Or, yeah.
You know, and then, like, but every third song has some weird ad in it. But then when I put together the, when I listened to, like, 13 hours of KHJ music to kind of put together the soundtrack, you know, frankly, you know, as much as I was liking the music, it was, like, the commercials that I was really, the good ones that I was really digging on.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We could have a whole sidebar on quality of commercial these days.
Yeah.
My fourth quote is from page 43. Okay, it's a visual for everybody. You can picture Brad Pitt or just Cliff. Mm-hmm. Cliff has also been known to travel great distances with his pants tight around his ankles, with only his fully erect penis to guide the way.
Yeah, I think that's definitely better if you picture Brad.
Well, I couldn't decide what was funnier. I mean, this is a part of the book I, like, stopped reading. I, like, was laughing out loud because the been known to made me laugh. And then the travel great distances. I'm like, there's a double joke, like, phrase by phrase here. And so many sentences are like that. It's beautiful.
Thank you.
And then the last quote that I pulled out, although I got lots of honorary mentions, is this one's related to books. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a scene here where the Rick Dalton is asked by Mirabella, you know, what are you reading? And he says a Western. And then she's like, well, what's it about? And then this is going to help us dovetail Quentin into the book conversation, because he says, the narrator says, though Rick has never really thought about it before, he kind of now realizes that reading Western paperbacks is one of the most solitary activities that he partakes in. So being asked to explain to somebody what's happening now in the book he's reading is just not something he's used to articulating. I thought that was such a good metaphor for the reading life that a lot of us inhabit kind of in a lonely and invisible way. Readers can relate to that.
I actually really like the idea that, you know, for a long, long time that, you know, he's not on his phone like people now. For a long, long time, that was his, like, between-take activity, was just, you know, reading a Western paperback. But just the idea of, oh, you want me to tell you what's going on in the story right now? Well, you know, I can do that, but, like, there's, like, a little moment of, oh, God, I have to do that. I'm just so used to just being lost in my little director's chair doing this as a solitary thing that it was actually interesting making it a sharing project.
Yeah, I think that's true. And also one of the values we kind of real promote on this show, Three Books, is, bringing back the book as the sort of device of choice in any sort of lineup or waiting area, or, you know, I often leave my phone without my, or I often leave my house without my phone just purposely so that I'm forced to read the book. It's much harder, but you feel proud of yourself even if you got 20 pages read kind of in lineups throughout the day. So
half the reason to, you know, other than where you're trying to get to go to get on an airplane is to take like three books with you.
Yes, exactly, exactly. Okay, well, Quentin, I'm thrilled to jump in.
Oh, by the way, thank you so much for choosing those quotes. It suggests that you really like the book because you really picked really, really meaningful ones. I really appreciate it.
Oh, well, that, believe me, it's my pleasure. Afterwards, I'll send our contact a list of all the quotes I pulled, because those are my top five, but I have probably about 15 or 20 that really meant a lot to me, and I have them noted and... I'd love to send that. I'll send that over to you.
Please. I would be thrilled.
Oh yeah, my pleasure. And I really mean it. It was my absolute pleasure reading this gem. And you created a whole new subgenre here. We're going to talk about that. I really think the contemporary movie novelization is going to come back huge because of this thing. It's a masterpiece.
Well, that was one of the things I was actually thinking about when the book started doing so good on Amazon. And it's like, hey, man, this all bodes very well for the movie novelization.
Well, exactly. I mean, 92 Reservoir Dogs, you created that sort of that genre, right? We saw it in 93, 94, 95, 90. Like, I think 2022, 23, we're going to see this thing come back hard because of what you pulled off. Now, I don't know if everyone can do it, you know, like what you did, but we'll see.
Well, I like the idea that I specialize in taking, You know, I've spent the first part of my career taking debased subgenres of cinema and pump some light into them or some respect, and now I'm taking, you know, just above dirty books, the most debased genre of literature.
Oh my gosh, yeah. At some time in your future career as a man of letters, there's got to be like a Sidney Sheldon type romance kind of rejig that
yeah,
you can
right.
do.
Yeah, it's like a Judith Kranz kind of thing.
Exactly.
That's my now, Quentin, Scruples Part 3.
Do you have a preference on which of your three books we start with? I've got two of them right here in front of me. One of them was so out of print I could not get a copy. Do you have a preference, or can I just jump into one?
Oh, no, no. Go with your own order.
Okay, great. For each one, I'll give the listener a one-minute background to give them the idea of holding this book in the bookstore live with us.
Right.
By the way, Quentin, I don't know if you know this about the show, but I broadcast out of the left ear, you're in the right ear, so the guest, the listener, feels like they're in the middle of our couch, kind of in the middle of our conversation.
Oh, that sounds groovy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I got a lot of flack on it.
Those are with people who have their left side speakers blown out.
Exactly. Okay, we're going to start with When the Lights Go Down by Pauline Kael. I am holding this book in my hand. It is a 600-page hardcover. Pauline Kael, K-A-E-L, is the witty, biting, highly opinionated American film critic who lived from 1919 to 2001, and she wrote movie reviews for The New Yorker from 1968 to 1991. This book was published in 1980 by Holt Reinhart and Winston. Like I said, it's a gigantic 600-page hardcover, one of 15 books she put out in her career and her life. The cover is a two-toned fuchsia with Pauline Kael and When the Lights Go Down in a flying metallic gold and silver zooming onto a movie screen type of font. Dewey Decimal Heads, you can file this under 791.434 film. There is no film criticism category, interestingly. And this book is a summary of all of Kael's writings for The New Yorker from 75 to 80, just 5 years, including her reviews of Taxi Driver, Carrie, Star Wars, and many more. Quentin, please tell us about your relationship with When the Lights Go Down by Pauline Kael.
Well, at the end of the day, Pauline Kael is probably my favorite writer of... And not just favorite movie critic, she's probably my favorite writer. Definitely the writer that kind of means the most to me. And my relationship with this book was I didn't really know who she was too much before this because I knew of the magazine New Yorker, but it, being a kid from Los Angeles, I didn't get it, and it all seemed very Tony, so I was never drawn to it on the newsstand or anything. And I think I'd heard the name Pauline Kael, but she was just some New York critic. But when this book came out, this collection, she was on the Tom Snyder Show, the Tomorrow Show, and here she is, this old smart-ass broad, and she's on the Tomorrow Show, and she's being interviewed by Tom Snyder, and I'm like, wow, this chick is really cool. She's really neat. She's really witty. I like what she had to say about a couple of movies. I remember he was kind of nailing her about how much she liked Philip Kaufman's remake of An Invasion of the Body Snatchers. And he goes, okay, you said that movie was this fantastic thing. Come on, Pauline, get real. And her response was, hey, I'm not responsible for your taste.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
she
was
kind of like snappy.
Yeah, this lady is really hip. I really dug her on the talk show. And so what would happen is so I'm like, how old am I around this time? It's like around 78. I'm like about like 14 or something like that. So the thing about it was, what I would do is like during the weekend when I'd go to the movies, I'd go to, either this mall theater or this other mall theater. And I'd get there, and usually what I would do where other kids would go to the arcade and play games, I would go to like the B. Dalton bookstore that was in the mall and like usually
yeah,
go
of
in
course.
The cinema section and read stuff until it was time for the movie to start. And so I went to the B. Dalton bookstore, and then they had that book. I go, hey, that's that book by that woman that was on the Tom Snyder Show. So I never read her stuff before. So just being, I couldn't afford the book, but being in the bookstore, I cracked it open and looked up a film that I liked and started reading her review. And I was completely taken with her writing style. I was completely taken with her voice. I was completely taken with her knowledge and her opinionatedness, but also like just her wit, her just like incredibly intelligent wit. And I was just, I was in love with it, but I couldn't afford the book. So for, I think about like 3 weeks to a month, whenever I went to the movies every weekend, so every weekend I'd go, and I'd start going a little bit earlier each time so I could spend more time reading the book in the bookstore. And so I read quite a, you know, so at a certain point I'd read about like 6 or 7 reviews, and it was like, okay, F it. I need to get the book. So I got enough money to buy it finally. And I bought it, and that started me on my road to owning every Pauline Kael novel in various different printings. Like anytime I go to a used bookstore, I see if they have any printings of Pauline Kael's books that I don't own already, and I just buy them on account of a cuz.
Yeah. And she has so many. She's 15.
Yeah, she had quite a few. But I just loved her writing style. And the people who love Pauline Kael, as opposed to a lot of critics out there, like, you know, we remember her reviews. We oftentimes remember her reviews very explicitly. And like, you can talk to a Pauline Kael fan and like, oh, she liked this movie, she didn't like that movie. Like, I can't talk about a single critic and you just bring up a movie. Oh, well, she didn't like it. Oh, she did like it. Unless you just happen to remember it. No, but we know the movies that she liked and the movies she didn't like. Now, we can disagree with her and we can think she's full of it when it comes to this or that and the other. But, but I always remember her arguments. But there's probably nobody that I just, to this day, have more fun reading than Pauline Kael. And I really think that, like, when it, especially when it comes to me being a director, she was more influential to me than any other filmmaker. It was just her her theories on film I adopted as my own. It was like she was my film professor or something. And that is that's the book. That's the one that put me on the road where she kind of became my holy mentor.
Well, it's what an incredibly formative book, and the idea that, you know, first of all, I love the relationship between bookstore and movie theater. I think that is a powerful relationship in culture and society we don't talk about very much. And I like that you saved up for it, you know what I mean? Because we just had chapter 79 of the show, Juju Morales from Veracruz, Mexico. She's like, you know, it's a 2-week salary to buy a book down here for most people. It's like, we forget that books are luxury items, which, by the way, side note, thank you for making Once Upon a Time in Hollywood $9.99.
Like, yeah.
It's the cheapest book on all of Amazon, the top 100, other than a sticker book. I checked. You know, you made it so affordable. And then I also like this thing about the relationship here, because, you know, Pauline Kael, she kind of had a testy relationship, you know, like Woody Allen called her out. Some pretty powerful people kind of called her out, and they really argued with her. And like you said, she's got a controversy section on her Wikipedia profile.
Yeah, no doubt.
And exactly. And you know, page 291, I'm on it right now. She says the Star Wars, the only attempt at beauty in this film is the double sunset.
Yeah,
and
right.
actually, Quentin, I wanted to ask you this about thick skin kind of thing, because the last couple weeks I've been listening to every word you've put out, right? Like I said, I listened to every interview, every podcast. I went deep into the YouTube rabbit holes, and I listened to you, and then I hear a pretty common statement. And then I check the newspapers the next day, and it's like, you know, Quentin Tarantino was calling out his estranged father, or, you know, Quentin Tarantino and Jennifer Lawrence, quote, didn't work out. Or today there's a headline in The Hollywood Reporter, you know, Quentin Tarantino slams critics. And I'm like, this guy is living right now in the eye of a hurricane that's invisible to most people, which is that their name gets slapped around all the time. You've been called every name in the book. So has she. Pauline Kael has too. Like, can you talk to me about that muscle? Like, inside, how do you build the thick skin? We got pretty thin skin these days. You got thick skin. What's the ingredients to kind of letting that roll off you if you do it?
Well, when you just can't take that stuff seriously. Now, at the same time, it helps if you're not on Twitter. It helps if you're. It helps if you're not connected to all these things that are coming out. Look, I'm human. I'm doing press right now, so of course I'm going to Google my name every once in a while, and see what the stories are coming out. But you know, it used to be a situation where you did an interview for Details magazine or whatever it was, and then you did the interview, and that was that. You know, that was the piece. And maybe another interviewer would read that interview, and then he would, okay, so you said in Details magazine last year that blah, 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 blah. You know, that was it. Now you say something on a podcast or you say something on this, and all these different internet websites are, they're just trying to get clickbait. So they take something you said that could be fairly innocuous, or maybe you were even saying it as a joke, and they just, put this graphic headline to get people to click on it. And then you read it, and then sometimes they try to make a bigger deal of it, or sometimes they actually fess up that it wasn't really a big deal, but the headline was big. So if, quit and slam, I didn't slam anybody.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I wouldn't use that adjective to say,
of course
quit and fight back.
I listened to the interview. I agree. You didn't slam anybody. Yeah, that's the headline.
They just slather these adjectives. But it comes and goes. This will be gone 3 days from now. But it's not a big deal anyway.
Well, I hear a couple things. One is that you stay offline as much as you can in terms of Twitter and stuff. Number two is you recognize the fallacy of the argument when, you know what I mean? You may be curious if there's a good argument, but you also are like, that's wrong. You can hold that mental confidence.
Yeah.
And the third thing is the timeliness. You know, because of the news cycle's speed, you're just like, well, this will be old news. Those are three things I picked up in there. Is there anything else that you're doing just mentally, in terms of psyching yourself through this? Because I think about myself. I get a bad headline, I'm crying. I'm not going to get back up for weeks. Like I thought you were really demonstrating.
I've been doing it for a while. So I've had good pieces and I've had bad pieces. Nothing's come out that's necessarily a bad piece. It's just it's just sensationalistic stuff. But I've had like really bad magazine articles where people really go out to. To skewer me, but it all goes with the territory. Nobody likes it, but then it just passes, and F it.
Yeah, exactly. You can swear on this show, by the way.
Oh, okay,
fuck
great.
It, there's no problem here. This is we are a non-censorship podcast. anti-censorship. I can't have Quentin Tarantino on and censor the guy.
Okay.
There's no limits here, man. It's your show. Okay, Pauline Kael quotes. You can agree or disagree with these. Here are five of her quotes. The first prerogative of any artist in any medium is to make a fool of himself.
I agree with that. I think what she's meaning is going for it. I mean, putting yourself out there and not stressing the consequences. You know, if you really put yourself out there, you can come up with great rewards, or you can fall on your face. But that's when you're trying something.
Exactly. I actually dug up an old quote from you that says, "There's nothing to be afraid of. Failure brings great rewards in the life of an artist."
That's very true.
Okay, number two from Paul.
I agree with you.
Number two, in the arts, the critic is the only independent source of information. The rest is advertising.
You know, that's very correct. I mean, look, there's not a filmmaker in the world that couldn't bitch for the next hour and a half on film critics.
Yeah.
People who judge their work, you could definitely do that. But despite the fact that you like getting the good ones for sure, but who the fuck is this guy to talk about this stuff? They obviously don't know what they're talking about. Blah 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 blah. All right, you can all those things. It's easy to feel a knee jerk response, but she is correct. Without criticism, it is all just advertising. It all is just flacky public relations.
Yeah. Yeah. One of my favorite clips, by the way, I watched of you to prepare is you telling an interviewer, this is a commercial for my movie. I'm not talking about that. This is a commercial for my movie.
Yeah, right. And I got criticized for that. And I go, screw you. That's exactly what it is. Why do you think I'm sitting here?
Oh, that's why I loved it. Because you're like, everyone knows that. I mean, that's why I've always had an issue with the late night talk show in general. It's like, we're all pretending that these are friends who are hanging out in suits with like one perfect anecdote. Like, this is bullshit.
Yeah, right. Well, and especially like the way talk shows have gotten now. I mean, I do them and I have fun when I do them. But, you know, it's a whole comedy routine. But I remember when I was a kid, people would go on the Johnny Carson show, and yeah, you know, they were always trying to be funny. But it was a legitimate conversation.
Right. It used to be.
And it could be rambly, and it could be this. But, like, you know, that was what Johnny was for.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And now it feels like everything is kind of
everything
like
is like, you know, it's like, you know, everything is like you're sort of like, I have no problem with this, but everything is like, no, it's like 5 minutes on the Comedy Store.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, one or two more quotes, then we'll go to your next book. Sex is the great leveler, taste the great divider.
Okay, say that one more time.
Sex is the great leveler, comma, taste is the great divider.
Yeah, I think I would probably go with that as well. I mean, more about the taste aspect more than anything else, because Pauline Kael used to love thumbing her nose at like the big foreign films of the day that all the other critics were creaming about.
Mm-hmm.
And she liked finding the, not so much the exploitation movie, but the slightly disreputable genre that she could find and champion and make a big case for. Like, one of the best reviews in that book, it's one of my favorite reviews I've ever read of in my whole life, is her review of Brian De Palma's Carrie.
Yes, I read that review.
It's fantastic. I mean, it's fantastic. I mean, it's right. It's actually right up there with the movie, and I think the movie's a masterpiece. But the review really captures the movie to become almost a thing unto itself.
Exactly. Did she ever review any of your stuff?
No, it's interesting because she retired in 91, I believe. And
yeah.
I was in pre-production on my first movie, Reservoir Dogs, when she retired. And I was heartbroken because my goal and part of my goal in life was to have Pauline Kael refer to me by my last name. Oh, so when Tarantino does blah blah, blah. Or Tarantino assumes blah blah blah, or Tarantino wishes blah blah blah, but what Tarantino truly delivers is blah blah blah. All right.
I like that it's not just reviewing a movie of yours, just the referring to you by your last name.
Yeah, just
that's
the way
the
that, like, she would refer to people by their last name. Peckinpah, thanks, blah, blah, blah.
Okay, how about this one? If there is any test that can be applied to movies, it's that the good ones never make you feel virtuous.
Well, that's something where me and her are actually exactly on the same page. She was, She had a cynical streak about her. And actually, if you read her reviews, you actually realize that she actually had a very sentimental streak. But she fought against the sentimental streak. She didn't like it when movies went for your heartstrings. When movies, like, you know, made you cry in a cheap way. She goes, you know, she was like, oh, yes, I'll cry. I'll sit there in the movie and cry because they got me. But I'm mad at them for getting me.
Yeah. The way you feel after you watch, like, a one-minute Google advertisement, you're crying.
Yeah, she goes, you know, that's cheap. That's cheap. Now, you can make me cry on my own terms or on your own terms, but yeah, but that's just, you know, yeah, I cried because I'm a human, but F you.
Yeah, I like that. Well, listen, Quentin, thank you for going deep on there. I have actually two more questions on Pauline Kael. I don't know if we have time, though. I got one on feet, and then I got one on freedom. Any of those intriguing to you, or should we move to your second book?
Okay, one on, no, go ahead, yeah, let me hear freedom.
Okay, freedom is, you said on Joe Rogan, I'm lucky I get to do whatever I want. And you know, that's so true. You mentioned that you got two books kind of in the docket coming or whatever, and you got a play that you want to do, all this before your kind of final 10th film. Mm-hmm. Well, Pauline Kael also had a lot of freedom. She was approached by studio bigwigs. She was asked to get more involved in the industry. She kept saying no. She's like, I want to write reviews. Well, you got to imagine like the pay and the fame, all this stuff was a lot lower in certain things she's deciding. So my question to you, and I can't ask her, but the question to you is, when you get to do whatever you want, how do you decide what to do?
Well, you know, that's a really good question. I think it's conceivable. I can only speak for myself. I think it's conceivable if you're not on an artistic path, if you have an artistic journey and you have a path set up for that journey, I think it makes it a lot easier to walk down that path. And when you have this kind of freedom, then you don't have all the obstacles that other people have to deal with. But if you get a tremendous amount of success and you get a tremendous amount of freedom, but you're not on an artistic path, you're not on an artistic journey, then you can get really, really lost. Because, you know, you don't know what to do. You did something and it did good, but you don't know why that did good.
Right.
You think you caught lightning in a bottle. You don't know if you can produce it again, and now you want to produce it again, and so you're lurching out. I mean, in my case, you know, I had certain stories I wanted to tell. Yeah. And then so I never knew what the next one was really going to be when I was doing whatever one I was doing. And it was all about that one. And then when that one was finished, then gone all around the world selling it. And then, you know, then I calm down. Then I'm just resting. And then the next story comes to me. And once I started writing it and I realized, oh, this is going to be the next thing I'm going to do, well, then I was all in. Because, you know, it would be different if I was looking for a book to adapt or reading other screenplays, trying to find something that excited me. I would probably be more trepidatious and more like, oh, is this the right one? But since I'm writing them all, yeah, of course this is the right one.
Yeah, and I've heard you talk openly about, you know, how your stories and characters kind of present themselves to you, and you make a mixtape, you check if the music is going to kind of match the genre you're interested in, whether that's blaxploitation or whether that's, you know, a spaghetti western or whatever,
yeah.
and then you kind of write the first scene, and if it kind of crackles off the page, you know, you got something. And I love your process. It's very fascinating to me. At the same time, you say, like, I heard you say something like, you know, the next story. But like now, like, you know, so now you could, you've decided the next two things are two books, a play, and then a 10th and final film.
Yeah, I mean, that's the idea right now. But, you know, we're talking about a couple of years by the point that I get through all that. So, yeah, we'll see.
You have helped us open up, and you have just sold a lot of copies of Pauline Kael's books. I had not personally heard of her at all until you told me to go buy the thing. So I appreciate it. Yeah, well, you know, thank you for bringing me into this world that I knew nothing of. I never had the you know, B.W. Dalton's kind of experience that you did. and I guess that's kind of the same for your second book, too, which is called, drum roll, please, 9:30:55 by John Minahan, Minahan, published in 1977 by Avon Publishing. This is the movie, this is the novelization of the film, September 30th, 1955, written and directed by James Bridges, which tells the story of a young college student named Jimmy J, a giant fan of James Dean, whose life falls into disarray after James Dean's death. The cover is a collage of black and white photos from the film, kind of similar to your cover here. 14's in a convertible, color close-up of Richard Thomas, and the tagline, "The world was forever changed."
The cover is meant to evoke like a yearbook or something.
Yeah, exactly. Jane Minahan lived from 1933 to 2002. He wrote 24 novels to his name. Quentin, tell us about your relationship with 9:30:55 by John Minahan.
Well, this is in the 70s. The movie actually didn't come out because it didn't get a big release from Universal, so it didn't really come out until like the beginning of 79, but it was meant to come out in 77, and that's when the book was published. This was at the height of me reading novelizations, just, you know, going through, or just paperbacks in general. But going to the Kmart or going to the 7-Eleven with the book spinner rack and just seeing what looked good. And I remember this being made because I remember just a couple of TV guide pieces about Richard Thomas, who was the star of the Waltons at the time, was doing a feature. And so, and I can't even tell you right now what made me pick that book out of the spinner rack and buy it. Because it wasn't like a movie I was looking forward to, or it wasn't overly enamored with Richard Thomas, even though I quite like him now. I think it just must be that I just bought a lot of books. And so I bought that book, 9:30:55. And then I read it, and I was completely taken with it. I thought it was just fantastic. It tells the story of a young student in the 50s who's in the Arkansas college in Arkansas, and it shows his like life for like his first couple of years in college, and how he first kind of starts discovering cinema in an interesting way. First he has a big revelation when he goes and sees Streetcar Named Desire. Mm-hmm. And he has a real connection to Tennessee Williams. He has a real connection to Elia Kazan. And he has a real connection to Marlon Brando. And so he starts getting Tennessee Williams plays and reading them. And he starts seeing the other Brando movies. And he's watching other Elia Kazan movies, all leading up to him going to seeing East of Eden.
Yes.
And when he sees East of Eden, he's just...
Steinbeck book turned
yes,
film.
Yes, exactly. And he's just floored, absolutely floored by James Dean's performance. And one of the things the book does really good, and the movie does this pretty good too, is, you know, James Dean predated rock and roll.
Yes.
And before there was rock stars, you know, for the most part... kids in the South, especially in the South, young boys in the South, you know, if they had heroes, they were usually sports heroes.
Right.
And you know, they didn't have, like, you know, they didn't have young heroes of that were their age, like the way James Dean was, or even though he may be a little older, but or that didn't represent them. But James right. Dean actually represented them when they saw him in East of Eden, and their parents yes. didn't understand, and the stupid critics who thought he was just a poor man's Marlon Brando, they didn't understand, you know, but they understood. And when they lost him, suddenly, when they thought that they were going to be able to see him...
Age 26, I think.
Yes, exactly. When they thought they were going to just see him in movie after movie after movie, you know, it seemed incredibly cruel as far as they concerned. He was theirs, and now all of a sudden he was just gone, and that was it.
Car accident.
And now, you know, pretty soon rock and roll would come out, and then there would be Elvis Presley, and then there would be all kinds of other people to kind of take the place of James Dean, and soon young people would get used to losing their heroes from time to time.
Yeah,
but that hadn't really happened yet, and so the story takes a turn once James Dean dies. Is like the kid a big section of the book, the whole last third of the book, is after James Dean dies, and it all takes place oddly enough 5/31 1955. It's like the day after he died. And it's him just kind of dealing with his, like, sense of mourning about James Dean and what it all means. And, like, the fact that none of the other kids in school kind of understand what a monumental thing this is, you know, part of his chagrin. Now, what is great of, okay, but let me tell you about my experience about the movie versus the book. So I read the book in 77, and I absolutely loved it. I thought it was terrific. And but then all of a sudden then the movie didn't get released. It got put on the shelf, and it was supposed to right. come out in 78, and it didn't. And then eventually it came out in early 79. Universal put it out, and it was came out on the lower half of a double feature with the Michael Douglas movie Running. So it played in drive-ins okay. and in third-run houses. So okay. finally, it's playing at a third-run house, a third-run theater, you know, by my house. So I run to go see it, and so I go to see it. And I hate the fucking movie. But the reason I hated it is because the movie only dealt with the last third of the book.
Oh, interesting.
The movie deals with just, from the point, James Dean pretty much dies at the beginning of the movie, and it's at
the kid
last
goes nuts.
Third of the book, the kid's response to it. And I like that part, but I liked everything that happened before even better. I mean, the book starts 2 years before the events of the movie. It starts with him going to college, and even like a little bit before that, frankly. And now what's really interesting about this is the screenplay is obviously based, James Bridges wrote the screenplay, it's obviously based on his life. He's obviously Jimmy J. It's a very autobiographical piece.
Hmm.
So the idea that John Minahan came in there and then just adds like an entire half a book
yeah,
to the story. And later, years later, I actually saw that like once it gets to the events of the movie, it's the writing takes a little bit of a backseat. It gets a little bit more standardized. He's just kind of novelizing the screenwriting prose to some degree. He's a very good writer, so he does it really good, but it's not as completely rich.
See, I'm confused because I get it's a movie novelization as your book is. At the same time, I heard you say in other interviews you wrote the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood originally in like prose form.
Yeah.
I guess I assumed when I read what you just told me, I thought, well, this book maybe was written before, but you're saying no, he actually added the first couple acts to the whole thing.
Oh yeah, no, he was it took me years before me to actually look up John Minahan, and he wrote quite a few novelizations.
Yes.
And his novelization, yes. I mean, he's the best novelization writer I think there is. His novelizations all work.
Interesting.
And he seems to really have a knack of picking books that would be, picking movies that would be good books. And one of the things that he does in most of his novelizations, not all of them, is he always makes them first person.
Oh.
So the book is being told from Jimmy J's perspective. And just telling any movie but from a literary first-person aspect does change the story. But it's just how much he added to it. Now, the thing that was interesting as time has gone on, because, like, I loved the book when I read it in 77. Then, like, it's one of those books that I really love. So I'll take it out every 6 or 7 years and read it again.
Wow.
And now the thing in the movie is the movie owes a little bit of a debt to the film Summer of 42, to some degree. That, in the way the book doesn't. But when I read the book the first time, I had never read Walker Percy's novel, The Moviegoer.
Right. Neither
and
have
now,
I.
Now, yeah. Since then, I have read The Moviegoer. And when you read 9:30:55, you realize, oh, okay, well, Minahan is definitely influenced by The Moviegoer. But if you ask me, his book is better than The Moviegoer.
Right.
I always thought The Moviegoer is a little overrated.
Yeah, and Minahan also wrote Jeremy, he wrote Mask, he wrote The Great Robbery series. And
he had the whole series of the Great Robbery thing. But his Jeremy novel is a magnificent YA novel.
Oh, okay. I'm going to put a star beside that. Jeremy. And you know what's interesting is that, I'm reading the movie summary on IMDb, and it's like, later that afternoon, Jimmy J sculpts an Academy Award statue out of mud, strips to his underwear, smears himself with mud, and conducts a ceremony to summon James Dean's spirit. And then I'm like, I keep reading, and it's like, Jimmy arranges for a seance to James Dean, but his friend Billie Jean, who dresses up like Vampira, drops a candelabrum, if I said that right, on her cape, and it catches fire, leaving her badly burned. Jimmy J is arrested. I'm like, whoa, this is kind of a wild movie, and it made me think of a quote you said recently, Quentin, on Real Time with Bill Maurer. You said, there has become a thing that has gone on, especially in this last year, where ideology is more important than art. Ideology trumps art. Ideology trumps individual effort. Ideology trumps good. Ideology trumps entertaining. And I totally horribly out of context, but in Joe Rogan, you use the word McCarthyism, like a tinge of McCarthyism. And I'm like, man, we are living in one of the most judgmental eras of all time. I mean, just there's a rush, no matter what, to be saying the right words, to be saying the right phrases, to make sure that person's canceled or that person's not. And it's like, you're one of the most active proponents of free speech, I believe, we got. And I admire you, and I'm following, I got my fist raised right behind you. What's the sort of balance between this kind of like progressivism and artistic freedom and censorship, if those are even the right words? Like, what do you say to young people trying to make art today? And just open that up for me a little bit more, because in Bill Maurer, you only had like a 30 seconds on that, but I'd love to hear more of what you're saying. And
well, you know, it depends on what kind of, you know, art you want to do. I mean, if you're a stand-up comedian, you should be able to push the envelope and say the jokes you want to make. And you know, we never held taste, you know, to truth-tellers that much. That was almost part of the thing, was almost like what Pauline Kael was saying, you know, was, the ruder you were, the more profound you could be. It was, you know, it was the old biddies in the 50s that were worried about decorum and taste.
Right.
And then, but like, you know, if you're going to be, I mean, somebody asked me today on an interview, and they go, well, Rick Dalton uses from time to time the F word, and I didn't know what he meant by the F word, and but he was like, he meant the slur for homosexuals.
Okay, yeah.
And I was like, well, yeah, I mean, that was the time, and he's this macho cowboy guy. Yeah, they threw that word around a lot, and they didn't necessarily mean homosexual every time they used it. They just threw it around a lot, you know, and he goes, well, how do you feel about using it in the book? And I go, well, you know, the novelistic narrator isn't using it. That's Rick.
Right.
And that's true to his, that's true to his sense of speech. That's true to the sense of the kind of dude he was.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's like, you know, so I've always just believed that, like, especially if you're writing dialogue for characters and everything, you know, you've got to tell the truth. They have to speak the way they would speak. And if people don't like it or it's ugly, so, well, sometimes you're not supposed to like it. Sometimes it's supposed to be ugly.
Yeah, there's a quote from you. As a writer, I demand the right to write any character in the world that I want to write. I demand the right to be them. I demand the right to think them. And I demand the right to tell the truth as they would.
Well, I still believe that to this day.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let me say one more thing about 9:30:55, if I could.
Yeah, please, please.
So one of the things in the book that's just so terrific, and it's so much better than in the movie, and I like the movie now. I actually watched the movie this last year after having not seen it since then. And I really liked the director, James Bridges, quite a bit. So I watched it again, now knowing what to expect. All right, I watched it again, and I actually quite admired it. However, but the thing about the book that really, really works so well is, one, Jimmy Jay is a really great character, but the character that's just really terrific is the nutsy girl that he falls for. This
yes.
character, Billie Jean Adams.
Yes.
And in the movie, she just doesn't work. I mean, she's just a kook. In the movie, she's just a kook. But in the book, she's one of the great, tragic, vaguely mad, you know, young, temptress female characters of literature. Now,
yeah.
Like I said, he was definitely influenced by the moviegoer, and the character, you know, is vaguely similar to the wild nutty girl that the character's in love with in the moviegoer. But again, Billie Jean Adams is a better character.
Yes.
She's better written. I mean, I think she's one of the great, you know, nutty young infatuation for the young male lead in literature. She's just a really magnificent character, and she's so richly drawn. I mean, when you read the book, you cannot believe this is not John Minahan's story.
Right. Well,
I mean,
that's interesting.
It feels like he's writing his own life story.
Well, this is the thing. It's so this novelization of this film is so different. Even in title, right? The film's called September 30th. They changed it because they didn't think the slashes 9:30:55 make sense. Even yours, the title's different. You took out the ellipses.
Yeah.
You've added tons of scenes. You've added lots of backstories. It's just so enthralling. For all the people listening, and we talked at the beginning how we think that the subgenre of contemporary movie novelization might come back. What are two or three principles, Quentin? Like, if you're turning a movie into a book, what are two or three of the principles for how to make sure the book on its own kind of stands up and holds on its own and can be, you know, maybe in decades in the future described as better than the movie sometimes, you know?
I think you need to do more than just take the screenplay prose and turn it into novelistic prose. You need to do more than that, than just add, you know, Rick said, Cliff said. I think you need to a movie is a movie. You have a certain amount of time, and there is a thing about when they take serious novels and try to turn them into a movie. Well, the movie's never going to be the novel. They have to fashion a movie out of the book.
Right.
And I think the reverse is true. You have to take this movie that works in this one way and fashion a book out of it. And the way you fashion a book out of it is you get to much more of an unlimited time, and you don't have to you have a different kind of pace. You don't have to have the pace of a movie. Now you have the pace of a well-paced novel. But you get to, tell us stuff we don't know. Expand on the characters' inner life, their backstory, or just, there's a lot of things that, wouldn't work necessarily in a movie, but that can work fabulously in a book. I mean, just to give you an example, make a clear example with my with my movie and book. All right. Well, okay. One of my favorite chapters is the chapter Drinker's Hall of Fame, where
second last chapter.
James Stacy and Rick go to, after they finish the Lancer episode, they go to a bar in San Gabriel and just drink and shoot the shit for a while.
Right.
Okay. Well, there's no way I'm making a big movie and I'm gonna throw in the third act a scene where the two characters go into a bar and shoot the shit for 40 minutes.
Yeah, exactly.
That's not a movie. That would not fly. It could be a really good scene, but that's not really a good scene for the third act of your movie. But it was a great chapter for the third act of my novel.
Why does that work in the novel? Because I will say, when I got to that second last chapter and it's this lengthy kind of hangout scene, Cliff, Rick, kind of at the bar, of course, your dad is making an appearance there. You make an appearance and references to getting an autograph for you from Rick. It threw me because I was like, whoa, I was expecting. Well, I guess, you veered so far off from the movie.
Yeah.
So I guess the question is, how did you know that would fly there? What is the storyteller's mind telling you there versus the movie?
Well, in the movie, even though I wasn't telling a plot-driven movie, I actually felt that Rick and Cliff, just knowing who they were was the plot. Getting to know them was the plot. But at the same time, you're moving forward. So a 40-minute scene where they just talk about interesting interesting work chit chat. All right. Well, that's not going to really. I mean, that's you could conceivably do a shorter version of that in the first act.
Mm-hmm. But why does that work in the book?
Conceivably, do a shorter version of that in the second act, but you're not going to do that in the third act when you're trying to get to a climax. But in the case of a book, either I've grabbed you with the characters or I haven't.
Right. Yeah, you're making a bet that we want to hear what they're up to and what they're going to talk about.
And it has that big monologue, so I know I have a big ending.
Yeah, exactly.
It has the Three Georges monologue, so that's it's all a preamble, knowing that I'm leading to that, and that's a big moment.
Well, I gotta say, when he says, "Oh no, not the Steve McQueen story again," I, as your reader, was like, "Oh, not the Steve McQueen!" Like, I totally felt the anger of that again coming up.
Yeah.
So you got me. Okay, Quentin, I'm holding your third and final book. I was able to get it. It is the one and only Semi-Tough by Dan Jenkins, a Texan author and sports writer who lived from 1928 to 2019. It came out in 1972 in hardcover from Anthenium, and I am holding the drugstore paperback from Signet Classics in my hand.
Yeah, I think Top that's the only version I've ever had.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how long the hardcover
it's like
lasted.
Sexy cowgirl on the football, I think.
Sexy cowgirl straddling a football, holding the laces like reins.
Yes, yes.
Which I thought was a very wise creative choice here. Semi-Tough is written in a varsity red and blue font across the center. Over eight months, a super bestseller, and the front blurb is from, of course, Playboy, the funniest, raunchiest book ever written about football and football players. This book was made into the hilarious and timeless film starring Burt Reynolds and Chris Kristofferson. It follows the adventures of Billy Clyde Puckett, star halfback of the New York Giants, whose team has come to the Super Bowl in Los Angeles for an epic duel with the dog-ass Jets. File this one under 813.54 for 20th Century Fiction. Quentin, tell us about your relationship with Semi-Tough by Dan Jenkins.
Well, I think that I think they hedged their bets with that Playboy quote. I mean, a case could be made the funniest, raunchiest book ever written. Okay, not just about football.
Wow, I like that. You're dialing it up a notch.
Yeah, I discovering this book when I discovered it, I'd heard of the movie. In fact, I knew the movie was coming out, and I thought it sounded really cool. I'm not a football fan. I'm not a sports fan at all. All right, I saw the book in the store, and it wasn't the novel. It wasn't the movie tie-in. It was that one I described with the girl straddling the football.
Came out a year or two before the movie, I think.
Yeah, this sounds pretty good. All right, so I picked it up, and right away, the first page just grabbed me. Talk about grabbing first pages, because I had never. Not only had I never read a book told in the first person like this before, I didn't even know you could do it.
Mm.
And the whole book is the whole idea.
May I read the first line for people? I guess by now there can't be too many people anywhere who haven't heard about Billy Clyde Puckett, the humminest sumbitch that ever carried a football.
And the thing is, okay, so it's like Billy Clyde Puckett is one of my favorite characters in any book. And the whole book is basically he's been hired to write his life story. And so the entire book is him talking into a tape recorder.
Yes.
About his, you know, dictating what he'd like the book to be. And at some point, I guess he's going to hand the tapes over to a typist and she's going to type it up for him. So the whole book is him just capturing this life story as it's going on.
Yeah, the 2 weeks before the Super Bowl.
Yeah, so he's telling his life story. So he's filling in his life story with all the stuff that's happened in the past between him and his buddy Sheikh, and then and his life and his football career. But it's also like it's the 2 weeks before the Super Bowl, so he's talking about that in a big way, and his love for Barbara Jane Bookman keeps coming out. But the point being, though, is he's such a funny, raunchy fucker.
Yeah.
And but I'd never read first person like this before.
Yeah.
It was like some of the greatest dialogue. The stories were absolutely outrageous, completely gross, and at the same time, strangely believable.
Yeah. Yeah.
In fact, the grosser they were, the more believable they were.
Yeah. Do you want to go into one of them, or I could say like the first page alone has like five or six different racial slurs. And you know, when you read the first one, you pause, the second one, you pause, the third one, you're like, he's going into this and it's not Dan Jenkins. It's the character.
Yeah.
And
it's Billy Clyde Puckett. I mean, the one that I think that stands out the most, because I remember it was one of those books that I didn't recommend it to anybody, but next thing I knew, like in sixth grade, like a girl was reading it. And then another guy was reading it, and they were like would recite passages from the book, and it wasn't the kind of book I would imagine that like would
no. You wouldn't want your sixth grade child to read this.
Elementary school kids or junior high, but like it was so naughty. It was so naughty that like you read a passage, you had to read it back. I think remember one of them was there's like the kind of like the monster guy on the football team, the maniac monster,
yeah.
Behemoth guy,
the guy that farts on everybody.
Yeah. Yes. Exactly. And they tell that this is not going to sound funny. Me telling it, it's just going to sound gross. And I'm not a fan of scatological humor, but it's very funny in the book. Where I think it's supposed to, I can't remember if it's like it's just he's having sex with his wife, or it's the honeymoon, or whatever the hell it is. But she's in the bathroom and she comes out ready to have
sex. It's her wedding night.
Yeah, wedding. I thought it was. It was a wedding night. And so he lies on the bed on his stomach and he opens his legs. And it's, I can't remember if he does it on purpose or if it's an accident, but he just ends up shitting all over himself in the bed. And that's not funny, me saying it, but it's very funny in the book, and it's very funny with that monster character, and it's really funny Billy Clyde reciting the story.
Yeah, he gets up, he gets on all fours, bends towards the bathroom as his brand new wife is exiting, and he has a theory that he's telling the guys in the locker room that, you know, if she can put up with my farts, our whole marriage is going to go great.
Oh, yeah, that's what it is. And he's going to fart, and then he just ends up shitting on himself.
Exactly.
Well, you can imagine me being in sixth grade thinking that was very, very funny.
Yeah, I can totally see why you like it. The confidence, too, right? The swagger. We heard it in that first sentence. Even the Pauline Kael review of this movie, which is in the book you had me read, she says this about Burt Reynolds. She says, he's convinced of his own charm. That's what carries the picture.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, I like the movie. I didn't care for it that much when it came out because it just wasn't the book.
Yeah.
And I held it against it. Well, they had to turn it into a movie. But even then, even though it's a flickering birthday candle compared to the book, Burt Reynolds is the perfect Billy Clyde Puckett.
Yeah. Yeah.
He plays him perfectly. He's as if he was born to play that character. His dialogue isn't quite as rich as it was in the book, but he is a terrific Billy Clyde Puckett. But the thing that when I had to choose the three books, the reason I chose this as opposed to say, I don't know, Larry McMurtry's All My Friends Will Be Strangers or something like that was. I was shocked at how exciting the first-person prose was, mm-hmm. and how exciting and funny and charming and rude a character Billy Clyde Puckett was, and that's carried through from the first page to the last page. I just didn't know anyone could write a book like that. I didn't know that was allowed.
Yeah, I mean, this, and even the way you describe sixth grade girls in your class reading it like kind of contraband tells you something about the entrancing nature that we can have in a relationship with literature that we often forget in this era of ladies and gentlemen making books for ladies and gentlemen. Like, we have to remember that literature can serve such a wide variety of emotional desires and needs, certainly a lot more than we may expect when we're assigned The Great Gatsby in grade 12.
Hey, look, very well said. I actually turned a gal I know who's one of my best friends about 6 years ago. I lent her Semi-Tough to read, and she fucking loved it. She was like, oh my God, this is one of the funniest books I've ever read in my life. And it's one of those things, if you do read the book recently, a Billy Clyde Puckettism is the word semi. Well, everything is semi-slow motion. he'll throw semi in front of an adjective. And, you know, God damn it, after you read the damn book, you start throwing semi in front of an adjective.
Oh, my gosh. It reminds me of mid-90s when everyone started saying hella after yeah, South Park. Right. You know, hella good. Hella. It's like, where did that come from? Yeah.
But one of the things that really made me actually add it on to the list, one is like my memory of it, but how good it was. But also, now, I've yet to write a book, I've written one, okay, but I've yet to write something completely in the first person. But I remember reading Semi-Tough, and I remember thinking, I think I could do this.
Yeah.
If I can write it like this, I think I could write a book.
Oh, this is your permission to be a writer book.
Yes, absolutely my permission to be a writer book.
Wow. Wow. Well, for Dan Jenkins, you know, hats off, because, you know, I just think if you're a Texas sports writer in the 1940s and 50s and 60s, as he was, like, mm-hmm. to the idea that you would inspire one of the world's foremost filmmakers, you know, 30 years after your books, like, that's pretty cool.
No, that's really cool, man. I'm glad to tell you that story, actually.
I love it. If we have time, I got two questions. You can pick one. One's about confidence, one's about family. Any of those entrancing to you, or should we move on to the closing questions?
Yeah, well, let's go with confidence.
Confidence. Okay. His confidence just jumps out at me, and it made me think, I got to say, as a consumer or a viewer or whatever of art, I'm like, I love the thick globs on like a Van Gogh painting. I love the dun-dun-dun-dun and like a Beethoven. The confidence. And, I rewatched five of your films in the last 2 weeks just to get ready for this. And, you know, it struck me, the opening credits, a film by Quentin Tarantino. And I'm like, that's it. You know, right away, he's not saying written by so-and-so, directed by so-and-so, based on a book by so-and-so. I'm like, it's like, this guy did it. This is the guy that did this. And one of my old business school professors, John Wells, used to say, management by consensus is bullshit. And which is funny in school, but then of course I got to the real world of working in companies, and all management is like, you know, matrix teams, and we all got to agree and consensus. I'm like, here's a guy that's coming out there, both Dan Jenkins and you, and like the confidence comes out. We get the vision, we get the true, every frame was Quentin approved. And like, you know, and I love that. It's kind of like, we want to see the Quentin Tarantino movie. Who cares what genre it is or what yeah. you know, what who's in it. So talk to me about that. And the reason, two things I want to know are, what are the artistic implications of having confidence like that? And what are the relationship implications? You know, and I ask that, you know, I'm a guy that puts my name on my podcast, my name on my, like, you know, for anyone that doesn't think they have an ego, you know, I got news for you. You got one. So talk to me about the, when you have one and you carry it through the way you have in this wonderful oeuvre you've created, what are the costs artistically and relationship wise that come with spearheading a vision kind of through all the way to the finish line every time?
Well, you know, it's funny because, you know, like I said a little earlier, if I was trying to figure out stuff for myself to do just as a director, and it was like the whole thing of like, you know, like reading galleys of unpublished novels, trying to find the next thing to do, or reading stacks of scripts to try to find something that inspired me, and I was just interpreting other people's work, you know, I don't know if I would have that confidence. Mm-hmm. But the idea that, you know, I write the scripts myself. The idea that I remember the day when this script didn't exist, when it was like a notepad, and I wrote the very first page.
Right.
I remember that day. I remember yeah. that day very well. There was a time before that, you know, even when the film is completely finished and it is what it is, there was a time that there was, not only was there no film, there was no nothing, there was just blank pieces of paper, and I remember filling in those blank pieces of paper. And you know, and if I didn't like the script, I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't make the movie. But I go through this big writing process, you know, similar to the way somebody writes a novel when I write my scripts. And so by the time I get to the end of it, you know, I'm all in.
Right. I
love the piece. I've seen the movie, and I know the movie worked, and I've made it work on the page. And if I made it work on the page, I know I can do it on the screen.
And then so how do you like handle the relationship?
It yeah. gives me the confidence. I mean, another way, I can give you a metaphor for it. It's like, because I put so much in the script and I'm so confident of the script, you know, it's like I'm a trapeze artist or a high wire walker, you know, in a huge, big top tent. I can do what I can do because I have this safety net.
Yeah.
Right
yeah.
underneath me. But you don't seem to be convinced of my answer.
No. I'm sorry. It's not that I'm not convinced, and I hear you. And it's just that, okay, I heard you say in another interview, Quentin, you're like, I think Brad Pitt's still mad at me for cutting the Charles Manson Ooga Booga scene from yeah. the movie, which is a big scene in the book.
Yeah.
And I thought to myself, here you got maybe the most A-list actor in the world, Brad Pitt, telling you what he thinks should happen in the movie. This guy is a huge movie. And you're like, no. You know, it reminds me of like the Barack Obama. My wife is a huge fan of Michelle Obama. She's like, and we kind of have this funny dynamic in our relationship because she's like, this is a lady that says no to the president a lot.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? Like, and I'm like, that's interesting. So you say no to Brad Pitt, then what happens after? Like, so for anyone listening to this who has confidence issues or who has a vision but doesn't know if they can kind of get it through, whether that's artistically or whether that's in a career, like to me, that relationship, how do you tend to the relationship issues, damage it, or
oh, yeah.
or
well,
like.
Well, you know, look, I'm lucky. I mean, look, you know, actors work with a lot of different directors and everything, and there's ones they agree with and ones they don't. And Brad wasn't mad at me. He just wished it was in there. He was like very curious about why it wasn't, and he seemed vaguely skeptical when I told him my reason. You know, but the thing about it is, you know, look, I'm just in a lucky situation. I'm not a first-time filmmaker. So the thing about it is, like, people are signing up to work with an auteur. They're signing up to work with somebody like me. And at the end of the day, I'm the boss.
Yeah. Well, there's that. I also hear a humility in there that I don't know if like I see a humility in there, which is that it's the art that leads you. It's not you that leads you.
Yeah.
Well, we're signing up for the art.
Yeah, that's definitely the case. I'm, you know, and I'm a human being like anybody else. Ego can get in the way, but that's usually when, that's when I'm making a bad decision. That's when it's not being pure, and normally I come to my senses.
Do you ever go back? Do you ever look back? When you look back on, say, Kill Bill, since we were talking about it, and I'm watching it, you know, and I'm still salivating, you know, mentally and watching it, like I'm into it. Are you now looking back and saying, ooh, I left that in and I shouldn't have, I should have put that in?
Not in Kill Bill. No, okay. I could be happier with Kill Bill. I'm happy with every frame of Kill Bill. I mean, like the only movies I probably feel that way about a little bit, and only just minorly, is Reservoir Dogs and Pulp Fiction a little bit. I mean, they're really good movies. But you know, I was learning how to direct.
Right.
So
right.
I look at it now, and I see some sloppy filmmaking.
Huh. Okay. Okay. Well, this has been a wide-ranging chat on the three books. But do you have time for a five or six fast, many-round question from some of your fans?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So the way I did this is yesterday I tweeted, I said, I'm interviewing Quentin Tarantino tomorrow. To the three books community out there, what would you like me to ask him? So these are the closing questions, and I got the very – I put myself in the last one.
Okay.
From Richardson Dackham, Quentin, what's a current Asian film recommendation or two you might have for me? I love Asian dramas.
Oh wow, that's interesting. God, I'm gonna have to give this guy a bad answer because, you know, I followed Hong Kong cinema starting from the '80s and through the '90s, and I was a huge champion of it. And same thing with the. With Korean cinema, but I have to say that for the last couple of years, I've kind of been out of the loop about it. So I don't really have a really good modern recommendation.
Well, do you have an old one? I mean, I haven't watched any.
I can definitely give a good.
What about for people that haven't seen anything?
Let me give an interesting shout out about a really fascinating director. For people who like old school martial art movies. There's a very interesting director that hasn't received her due. There is it's a woman named Kebo Shu, and she was the only female directing martial art movies in the late 70s and the 80s.
S-H-U?
Kebo Shu.
Shu, S-H-U.
Yeah, S-H-U.
Okay.
Yeah, and
okay, got it.
K-A-E, I think, Bo.
Okay, great.
But the thing is, she was the only female that directed a Shaw Brothers martial art movie, and it's a pretty good one called Lady with a Sword. She was also an actress, too. I think she worked in different Shaw Brothers movies. But then she started a company with her and her husband, and she directed about like six or seven movies. And some of the movies are some of the most violent of all the kung fu genre. There's one called Blood of the Dragon with Wang Yu that's like it's one of the bloodiest fight films ever, and it's just like this one man against a thousand army kind of movie, but it's really good. But the movie of hers that's like the most like Dorothy Arzner type, you know, where it's like there's definitely a feminine perspective worked into this really terrific martial art movie is a one with a great title, Bandits, Prostitutes, and Silver.
Bandits, Prostitutes, and Silver?
Yeah, because silver was the coin of the realm then.
Right. Okay.
And
good.
It
people
like
will remember
really
that one, and we'll put it on the show notes
Spaghetti
too.
Western. It has like the great Lo Lee, who's one of the great villains in martial art films, and it has the great Angela Mao, who's probably one of the great of the female fighters in this film. But you know, it has a really cynical spaghetti Western vibe. But even with the way they tweak the cliches and the drama, you can tell that a female made it.
Okay, we'll check that.
You can read the feminine perspective.
Okay, we'll check that out. And like I said, we'll put on our show notes at threebooks.co so people can get all these afterwards. From Vivi Solano, doesn't Hans Landa deserve a movie or series of his own?
possibly. Well, I don't know if I'm ever going to do it, but I had this whole idea when I was writing the movie, and I mentioned it to Christoph. That I doubt I'm going to do this, but it was a fun thing to think about. That so the war is over. Hans Landa has made his deal with America, and so he's living in Nantucket
with a swastika carved in his forehead.
Yeah, but he wears a wig, so people don't know that he wears a wig with bangs, so people don't see the swastika.
Okay, then what happens?
He goes home at night and he takes the wig off, and there it is.
Okay, so that's the opening.
So he's living in Nantucket, and he starts some business, like a hardware store or something like that, or maybe a bookstore. He's like he's a pretty learned guy, and maybe he teaches piano or something too, on his off time. And so he's just like this nice little German guy who's like a world war hero, as far as they know, in this Nantucket Island. But he's still a great detective.
Mm.
And then from time to time, when there's foul play or murder that happens on Nantucket Island, then Hans Landa uses his detective skills to solve the mystery.
Wow. Oh, my gosh.
Whole idea that there would be a series of Hans Landa mysteries.
And what's the angle of the detective? Like, what type of detective is he? Is he, because that opening scene of Inglourious Basterds, I mean, everyone I know found that totally riveting.
He's definitely in the Sherlock Holmes Nero Wolf.
I love that phrase, Nero Wolf. Okay, from Ahmed Mirz.
Drop the name Nero Wolf.
I will not be using that. I will definitely be using that again. From Ahmed Mirza, I can't believe I'm asking Quentin this, but what the heck? Quentin, how do you feel about the notorious memer at Quentin Quarantino?
I think it's a fairly clever use of my name. Pun on my name, yeah.
Yeah, so for those that don't know, 25-year-old Tommy Marcus, University of Michigan graduate based in New York, started this account during the pandemic after his second favorite director, because Wes Quaranderson doesn't rhyme as well as Quentin Quarantino.
That's very true.
But Tommy Marcus has the dance scene from Pulp Fiction tattooed on his left shoulder. He's got millions of followers, raises a lot of money for a lot of good charities, made a big donation to Planned Parenthood in Rush Limbaugh's name after his death. He does stuff online.
Anybody who tattoos my characters or a scene from my movie on their person for all time, they have a license too. They have a license other people don't have.
Okay. Wow. I like that. Okay. He's gonna hear that for sure. Okay. From Jeff Fraser, just a couple more. What is one book you have always wanted to see turned into a movie but hasn't?
Oh, that's interesting. That's a good question. The first thing that comes to my mind is a few books that have been turned into movies, but they weren't done the right way. All right.
Oh, okay.
So that would be a little easier. But let me think about that. I don't know if I really want to see it turned into a movie, but Larry McMurtry's All My Friends Would Be Strangers, if done right, could be a really terrific movie.
And then can I just say, what are the ones you think weren't done? You said the ones that come to mind first.
Yeah, well, the one that immediately comes to, that comes to mind is David Morrell's original novel for First Blood.
Okay.
Now, they did an okay job with the movie, but they just kind of turned it into an entertaining enough movie. But David Morrell's novel is really fantastic, and it's got magnificent dialogue. And they soft-pedal it in the movie, so they throw away the entire point of the book. And the point in the book is, if you take a soldier like Rambo and you turn him into this killing machine literally he is a killing machine. You turn him into that, to fight your wars. Well, when the war is over and you send him back into the population, well, you create a killing machine.
Right.
And you just can't shut it off. It's very similar to Roman Gary's novel, White Dog. You know, he's a machine now. You can't just hope that the button stays on off.
Yeah.
And these local yokel deputies, flip the switch, and he goes nuts. And the thing about in the book is that these stupid local yokels are chasing after him in a posse, and then at a certain point, once he gets in the forest, but the forest is similar to the jungle of Vietnam that he's used to, he turns it around, and he tracks them all down and kills them all. because you're a killing machine, and you know, and they're just a bunch of butcher bakers and candlestick makers.
Right.
Now, in the movie, they were Stallone didn't want to go that route because the overall no one's going to like Rambo if he just turns into a killer. So he has Rambo wound all the deputies. Well, that's not the point of the movie. That's not the point of the book. That's against the point of the book. There's no going back once you've created a character, when you create a person like that.
There is no such thing as a wounding machine.
The novel.
Yeah, there's no wounding machine.
Yeah. And it's like, but I mean, the book is just so good. I mean, it's one of those books where the dialogue is so good, you find yourself reading it out loud.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I mean, the sheriff character is just a magnificent character. And Rambo has these arguments with himself that are just really, really fascinating. And you know, and the Rambo character is a real three-dimensional character, not like what the character became. And I have a fondness for those movies, but it's not the book. It's just the book would make a hell of a movie, man. And it was almost made a bunch of different times. At one point, Peckinpah was going to make it. At one point, Mike Nichols was going to make it. And it just would have been terrific.
Hmm.
And it could still be terrific. It could be made tomorrow.
Well, when I hear your passion for this, Quentin, and you've talked a lot about how your movies are all like kind of a genre movies, right? The spaghetti western, the kung fu. And then I'm like, when I hear, because I always think, I'm like, well, what's the next genre that's going to catch this guy's attention? What other genre has he not explored? But I almost feel like every genre you talk about excitedly, you know?
Well, when I like something, yes, I guess that probably is probably true.
Yeah, I love it. Well, to close us off, you have been so, so, so generous with your time, with your thoughts, with your creativity, your wisdom, your movies, you're creating.
So this
Quentin,
is one of my funner conversations to have in a while. Thank you so much.
Oh, well, my pleasure. Can you leave us with a final piece of advice or hard-fought piece of wisdom for everyone? Think about the people out there listening to this. It's all 100% book lovers, writers, makers, sellers, and librarians. A lot of people out there are trying to write their first book or trying to create a piece of art or do something in their community. Is there a piece of advice you can leave our community with at Three Books just to close us off?
Gosh. I don't know if I'm the one to be giving advice, having just squeaked out one novel by the skin of my teeth.
And 9 screenplays.
Yes, okay, I have done that. I guess I would say that when it comes to the printed page, just do not censor yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you've got a story to tell, tell that story. Don't bend it to society. Don't bend it to public morals, or even the taste of your mother or your wife or your
mm-hmm.
husband. Tell the story you want to tell. Create the characters you want to create. I mean, one of the things that I've always really liked about literature and books is the fact that you can write a book about a perfect son of a bitch. But as long as the son of a bitch is interesting, that's all good.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody, you're not writing necessarily characters of to be moral paragons. You're right. The whole point is about them being interesting, and that's what's really important, because it's not about is a character good or bad. Are they interesting?
Uh-huh. Do not censor yourself. Don't bend to the morals of your husband or wife, and make the characters interesting. Quentin Tarantino, you are a very interesting character. Thank you so much for coming on Three Books. I so appreciate it.
It's my pleasure. This was a lot of fun, and you're a very charming fellow. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Quentin. Have a great day.
Thanks.
Congrats again.
Thank you much. Bye-bye.
Hey everybody, it is just me, just Neil again. I walked out of the furnace room, okay? Like, okay, I need the floor in there freezing. I had bare feet the whole time. My feet are like ice cubes. And now I've come over around the corner. Now I'm sitting in a closet because the baby's sleeping like a door away from me. I got the other kids sleeping like a 2 doors away. Did you hear my kids kind of coming in the middle of the conversation there? The thump, if you heard thumping, on the roof that wasn't your roof. That was the roof of the furnace room. And my kids kind of came down. My amazing, incredible, saintly wife, Leslie, thank you for taking them out of the house as I started that conversation and quietly getting them ready for bed by herself. I'm so sorry, Leslie, and thank you so much. And thank you to all of you. What quotes jumped out for you? What quotes jumped out for you? I wrote down so many little lines as we were talking just afterwards. How about this one? Half the reason to get on an airplane is to read three books. Not only did he say three books, but also, ain't that true? It's kind of like, if you know, you know. Same thing. And he said later in the interview, well, sometimes I don't know what I want to read, so I take two or three books. Who else does that? Who else? We came up to this lake out. Well, we're taking a suitcase full of books. You got to not only have books to read, you got to have what Nassim Taleb would call like your anti-library. You know, you got to have books to browse around on. You got to have things to see. You got to have the visual stimulation around you. I totally agree with that. So that was one of the quotes I picked out. And by the way, for those that are new here, I usually try to reference three quotes from the guest at the end before I list their three books and add them to the top 1,000. We're getting to that. How about this quote? Sometimes you're not supposed to like it. Sometimes it's supposed to be ugly. There's so much power in that phrase. Sometimes you're not supposed to like. Think about ourselves. How much of what we do is in order to be liked? In general, in our lives, how much of what you do is to be liked, to be likable, to get followers, to get clicks? We even labeled that and metricized, you know, likes, who cares about likes? It's about living your life. It's about living true to your values. It's about living with high integrity. It's about being true to your art, to your craft, to your family, to your business, to your loved ones. That's what it's about. Sometimes, you got kids? Well, you know, sometimes you're not supposed to be liked. Sometimes you can be a little ugly. Maybe I'm projecting my own current parenting approach as I do this podcast in the closet. Number three, do not censor yourself. The full quote is do not censor yourself. If you got a story to tell, tell that story. Don't bend it to society. Don't bend it to public morals or even the taste of your mother, your wife, or your husband. Tell the story you want to tell. Create the characters you want to create. I mean, we need to hear it from Quentin, don't we? Right? Who else is sitting on some piece of art that you're second guessing? A character that you're writing that you're not sure about, you're squeamish about, you're afraid to say something because you don't want to get canceled or you don't want to say the wrong thing in the day and age that we live in. We live in a very judgmental society, very judgmental. You make a mistake. People are going to hate me just for even interviewing this guy. People are going to hate me for interviewing anybody though. You know, I interviewed the teenage Mormon missionaries. I got so much love from some people, so much hate from others. It's the way things are. We got to stay true to yourself. Don't censor yourself more than anything else. Thank you to Mr. Quentin Tarantino for giving us three more books to add to our top 1,000. Again, for those who are new here, at threebooks.co/the top 1,000, we keep a record of every single formative book discussed on the show. Okay, the three books he added are number 758, When the Lights Go Down by Pauline Kael, K-A-E-L. Number 757, 9:30:55 by John Minahan. A couple things there. The name is written like the date, so it's 9/30/55. That is the date, September 30th, 1955, that James Dean was tragically killed in a car accident just at the beginnings of his acting career. And last name on that author, by the way, is Minahan, M-I-N-A-H-A-N. And then adding, of course, number 756, Semi-Tough by Dan Jenkins. It's written S-E-M-I hyphen T-O-U-G-H by Dan Jenkins. As Quentin said, the Playboy blurb on the front shouldn't say the funniest, raunchiest book ever written about football and football players. It's just the funniest, raunchiest book ever written, period. One quick call out on that. The very first, I said it in the interview, but just quickly, the first page of that book has, by my count, six different racial slurs to the point where I'm like Googling all these words. I don't even know what they mean. Is it Dan Jenkins? No, it's his characters talking. The characters in the era, in the vibe, in the locker room, it's a wild conversation. And so there is opinions about that. You might think, well, those words shouldn't exist. And so we don't talk about the words on the show, but I just want you to know that book, it's got a lot. There's a lot of words that you can't use in polite society littered throughout that book. Okay. So, I got to give some thanks. Before we get into the end of the podcast club, stick around if you want to hear what that's about. It's one of three clubs that we have in three books, including the Cover to Cover Club and the Secret Club. But we'll talk more about that in a second. First of all, big shout out to Rachel Alinsky. Rachel, thank you for your grace, for your passion, for you feeling the vibe of three books, for you hooking Quentin and me up. Thank you for carrying this through to the end. Rachel, thank you so much for your work. Manuela Beekmans, thank you so much for the really quick turnaround, trying to get this thing produced, prepared, getting ready. Dave Barway, thank you. I don't know if you guys could hear this or not, but Quentin was dialing in from a landline, right? I don't know if he had a cell phone or if it was like a plugged into the wall. Either way, it was a phone call. So I'm like, I can't figure out how to do that. So I hired Dave. Dave, you guys know him from chapter 58, David Mitchell. You may remember him. He was the guy giving me advice, and we brought him on board. Wonderful guy. He runs DB Audio. He figured out a way to patch Quentin's phone call through a computer so that we could record it through my computer. Dave, you are a gem. Thank you for doing that. As always, it's a village. You're my village. Thank you, Three Books community. Thank you, Three Bookers. Thank you for the new people that are here listening to this right now. Hope you check out a couple of their chapters, see if this vibe is for you. Thank you, more than anything, to Quentin Tarantino for coming on Three Books. And now, that's Neil Pasricha tapping the mic in the closet saying, if you're still listening, if you made it past the 3-second pause, I'd like to welcome you back to the end of the podcast club. This is the club at the end of every single chapter of Three Books where I talk directly to you. You talk directly to me. We play your voicemails from 1-833-READ-A-LOT. We read your letters that are sent in nasty comments or rave reviews. We pick out a word of the chapter, and you better believe Quentin's going to get a SoundCloud today, people. We talk about the etymology of one of the interesting words that Quentin said or one of our guests said every show, and we talk a little bit more just about what happened, okay? Are you down with the get down? Are you want to get going? Let's jump to the phones right now.
Hi, Neil. My name is Kat, and I'm from Bangor, Maine. I can be a part of the fan club, make it to the end of the podcast club all the time because I am constantly listening to podcasts in their entirety as I listen while I carve linoleum blocks for my art prints that I make. I just wanted to call and say thank you so much. I absolutely love this podcast. It was really fun to happen upon it. I was listening to Ologies with Ali Ward, and your episode came on, and I thought, what a fun idea for a podcast. I am similar to you in that I loved to read when I was a kid, and I'm certainly coming back to it now as an adult. I read a little bit before bed, and my husband and I just started a tradition recently that on Christmas Eve, we will buy each other a book and we will spend the night reading it. So I'm really looking forward to quite a few of the books that you've had mentioned on your podcast from your guests. And I'm really also interested to see if you get that translator on. If so, I would love to hear that. Hope you're doing well in all this COVID craziness, and keep up the good work.
Thank you so much to Kat from Bangor, Maine for the phone call. Okay, so much there to talk about. First of all, for those that don't know, the Cover to Cover Club are the people who listen to all 333 chapters of Three Books. Love you guys so much. Thank you for being part of that special, sacred kind of community within a community. And the Secret Club members, well, there's only the Secret Club, by the way, for the show operates entirely analog. It's entirely through the mail. You got to like mail secret things in secret envelopes, and you get secret things in secret envelopes. Can't say more about it, but the only way to get a clue for how to join is by calling our phone number, 1-833-READ-A-LOT. It's R-E-A-D-A-L-O-T. If you drop that last T, read a low. Sometimes that helps the number go through. That number is dialable from anywhere in the world. And yes, I'm paying for an international subscription. So if you're listening right now and you're in Tokyo or you're in Sweden or you are in Namibia, give me a call, okay? I'd love to hear from you. Now, a couple things here. Ologies. For those that don't know the podcast, Ologies, O-L-O-G-I-E-S, Ologies with Ali Ward is one of the world's best podcasts. It's a top podcast in science. I was the guest on a show called Awesomeology, where I went deep into all kinds of positive psychology research. And so if you're interested in hearing another side of me, I guess talking about the happiness research stuff that I do in my books and so on, check that out. Kat, I love the tradition. Christmas Eve, spend the night reading. I love that. Maybe Leslie and I will have to adopt that. For now, we are usually frantically writing our letters to each other. I don't know if I've ever told you guys this before, but early in our relationship, I had this brilliant idea to get out of buying gifts. I was like, Leslie, for the rest of her life, what will we value more? Like a present to each other on Christmas every year? Or looking back at our lives from our hundreds, you know, 70 letters, one letter that we wrote to each other every Christmas day. She bought into the concept. And so now every single year we write each other a letter on, usually we're writing it Christmas Eve because we give it to each other Christmas Day. No presents, just the letters. Now that we have kids, we're trying to do it, but the permutations and combinations are starting to get a bit out of hand. But that is our Christmas Eve tradition. It also reminds me of chapter 69 with Cheryl Strayed, author of Wild. You know, she talks about going to bed and reading out loud to her husband and being read to out loud. What other sacred reading tradition, writing tradition do you have in your relationship? We can go a bit gushy on the show. Give me a call. Drop me a line. Let me know. Okay. And now it is time for the letter of the chapter. And as you guys know, I love reading the hate mail. I love reading the hate mail that we get. It's fun to get hate mail. So I'm going to read a hate mail letter and I'm going to read a loving letter. I will read both letters to you right now. Okay. So first, the hate mail. Insufferable. Insufferable on iTunes US says Money Steve. Granted, I only listened to one episode and it was the one with Juniper, the most insufferable person I have ever heard. I couldn't stand how the host twice said, I totally agree with you. Now, what do you mean? Seriously, he said that twice. And that's just a single example of many exchanges which were hard to endure. I came for the focus on books. I will leave for the spineless, patronizing interviewer and the incoherent guest. Thank you for the two-star review, Money Steve. I appreciate that. Now, another letter. Okay. Oh, my gosh. Which one should we go to? We'll go to this one from Marilyn, 098765. And by the way, Steve and Marilyn, like I say every time, if I read your letter on the show, drop me a line. I'll send you a signed book as a way to say thanks. Okay? Same if I play your voicemail. Just drop me a line and we'll give us your address and we'll send you a book. This podcast is such a gem. Neil's conversations are my dream come true. I live vicariously through Neil's ability to navigate from small talk to deep dives into how a person became the person they are in this moment because of books. The Top 1000 has inspired a lifelong scavenger hunt for me. I have listened to every chapter, and when a new one drops, I add the three new titles to my handwritten list. Writing the titles down helps cement them in my memory. Then, whenever I come across a book from the Top 1000 in a bookstore, I buy it, even if I may not read it. This has become a real fantastic way for me to support local and independent bookstores. Part of my hunt is that I want to come across it in person, as opposed to ordering any of the titles online. It has become my three books collection, and I suspect it may be a lifelong hunt. As I write this, in June 2021, I have 114 books in my collection. Of the 241 titles on the list so far, they range from children's books to sports memoirs to science fiction to Chinese philosophy. I never thought I'd be the kind of person that organized their books by color, but the variety of topics makes any other scheme difficult. It looks beautiful. Neil, I love when you ask the fast money questions, especially the ones about how interviewees organize their books. Whenever you have time to do that, please do. Keep it up. I love your passion project. It brings me great joy. From Marilyn, from Smithfield, Virginia. Okay. And now let's head over to the word of the chapter. Here we go. Over to you, Quentin.
It seemed very Tony's, where people really go out to skewer me. You're lurching out. I would probably be more trepidatious, the spinner rack, and you know, part of his chagrin. The old biddies in the 50s that were worried about decorum and taste. In the movie, she's just a kook. Young, temptress, female characters of literature, figures of an infatuation. They have to fashion a movie out of the book that works in this one way and fashion a book out of it. The maniac, monster, behemoth guy. I'm not a fan of scatological humor. And these local yokel deputies, you're not writing necessarily characters of to be moral paragons.
Oh, yes, indeed. You better believe Mr. Quentin Tarantino gets our famous word cloud treatment. For those that are new here, we always pick out a word on the show that Neil Pasricha does not understand, doesn't know how to use, doesn't know the history. It started back in chapter 3, I think, with Seth Godin. He used the word patina, like in the first 5 seconds of talking to him. I was like, what's a patina? He's talking about the room we were in. He's like, how's a patina? I was like, what's a patina? David Sedaris talked about himself as Lilliputian. I was like, Lilliputian? What's he talking about? We started realizing that we needed to do a word of the chapter. And sometimes if the guest uses a lot of interesting words, we do a word cloud. That's a word cloud. You can always check out threebooks.co/FAQ if you want a list of every single chapter that includes a word cloud at the end. Okay. So many words here, Quentin. Hard to know which one to pick. Kook is a good one. Origin, of course, is from cuckoo bird. I did not know that. But instead, I'm going to go with a different word. Let's go with Tony.
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 That's T-O-N-Y, the adjective. Not to be confused with capital T-O-N-Y, the name. Or, according to Merriam-Webster, capital T-O-N-Y is a medallion awarded annually by a professional organization for notable achievement in theater. Could you be any more wordy, Merriam-Webster? Well, you know what a Tony is. Best musical for whatever. Cats. But he used it in reference to the New Yorker, a Tony magazine, or a Tony private school, marked by an aristocratic or high-toned manner or style. That's the definition, marked by an aristocratic or high-toned manner or style. According to the etymology research I just did, it's because 100 years ago there was a popular color. New color came around, reddish-brown. It was a popular fashion color in the 1920s, and it was of a high tone. Of a high tone, affecting social elegance. So the word Tony came to be referring to that particular color tone. That's why some people still spell Tony, T-O-N-E-Y. The E hanging out in there is kind of this leftover appendage. It's like the thing hanging down the back of your throat that you don't need. It's like a leftover thing from 100 years ago, referring to something as of a high social tone, like that new reddish-brown color. I'm smiling, thinking about you, finishing up your dishes, finishing up your workout. Did you finish a long drive? Did you hang out on the couch with us? Did you like it? I loved it. I loved it. I was gushing. I don't know. I probably sounded too excited throughout that thing. I'm sorry. I just fanboyed it. I went into it. This guy, like I said, he ain't painting the Sistine Chapel. But I think of Quentin Tarantino as not only one of our foremost defenders of free speech, which I think is so important in the world, but also one of the greatest living artists we have. More books, more plays, more movies await us all. This guy is a complete master. If you haven't already picked it up, please grab a copy of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Grab the movie novelization. You won't forget it. Yeah, it'll make you scream. It'll shake you. It'll rattle you. It'll provoke you. It'll make you uncomfortable. There are gross scenes. There are vulgar scenes. But it will stimulate a whole wide variety of emotions, and it will propel you through the book. Thank you so much to Quentin. Thank you so much to you. And until next time, remember that you are what you eat and you are what you read. Keep turning that page, and I'll talk to you soon. Take care.